Good morning, everybody. On behalf of our team at Hyderabad, it's my pleasure and privilege to be here, and I thank Dr. Bala Venkat and the Ganga Hospital faculty and the committee to invite me and give this privilege. Next 20 minutes, I shall be talking on this topic of management of major obstetric hemorrhage, where we stand. Just a little bit about this topic. It's related to my heart because I'm very pertinent. There's no mother should die of major obstetric hemorrhage, because as an anesthesiologist, during our post-graduation, we all possess clinical skills to resuscitate. It is just that lack of adequate knowledge or armamentarium and that leads to the maternal death. And as you see, in our country, hemorrhage is the leading cause of maternal mortality. And of course, the second leading cause even in the developed nation. And even in our ICU, it is the second most commonest cause of ICU admission. Almost 12% of obstetric ICU admissions are because of major obstetric hemorrhage. Well, greetings from Fernandez Hospital. Ours is a tertiary care referral center. But the problem here is we don't have level 4 intensive care therapy, which major of these patients who suffer from major obstetric hemorrhage, they need like plasmapheresis or renal replacement therapy or ERDS, secondary to massive transfusion. And as a team, we have taken up this new hospital, which has all these facilities, and to an extent, it's a sort of a little bit of relaxed atmosphere for the anesthesiologists. Well, again, two more questions for the audience. Critical hemoglobin value in a major obstetric hemorrhage in AS a grade 1 patient is A, hemoglobin of 6.5 grams, B, hemoglobin of 5 grams, C, hemoglobin of 4.5 grams, and D, hemoglobin of 7.2 grams. Anyway, I think it is not timed, but anyway, you will get the answers during my talk. Similarly, the lethal triad in massive transfusion is which of you is the right answer? You'll get to know during my talk. Well, if you see the common cause of major obstetric hemorrhage, where majority of the time the common obstetric conditions like preeclampsia, HELLP, abruption are the common causes, abnormal placentation like placenta previa, and with the increasing number of cesarean section incidents, the adherent placenta is a nuisance nowadays. If you read the Miller, the most commonest surgery performed in 1980s was tonsillectomy. In 1990s, 2000s, the cesarean section is one of the most common surgical procedures performed worldwide. Well, other causes are the intrauterine sepsis, septic abortions, and the postpartum hemorrhage, which is 80% of the cause of major obstetric hemorrhage is the postpartum hemorrhage, and we all know the four T's. I'll come to it. And the fifth T has been added recently. And of course, any patient who has jaundice complicating pregnancy or acute fatty liver are a risk and a threat. And other risk factors are long labor, past history of PPH, multifetal pregnancies, patients on anticoagulants, anemia, obesity. Well, most of the obstetric hemorrhage, if not all, can cause obstetric coagulopathy at a very early onset. And the commonest conditions that lead to obstetric coagulopathy are obstetric-related disorders like abruption HELLP, amniotic fluid embolism, fetal demise, sepsis again, septic abortion, jaundice, any cause, acute fatty liver of pregnancy. The incidence of coagulopathy is almost 100% in AFLPs and jaundice. Patients on anticoagulants and class 4 PPH, if inadequately treated, can lead to dilutional coagulopathy, or massive transfusion can cause dilutional coagulopathy, hypothermia, and acidosis. All are interrelated. So we need to understand the pathophysiology and the underlying mechanism so as to manage these patients appropriately. One of the commonest cause that we encounter in our practice is preeclampsia hypertensive disorders. Out of every 100 women, almost 8 to 10% of women have hypertensive disorders. And of these 8 to 10%, 3% of them have underlying HELLP syndrome. And if you have underlying HELLP syndrome, it is 70% of the time the presentation is biochemical. By the time they come to this stage of frank coagulopathy, it will be too late. And we need to have our own profiles or investigation backup to monitor them very closely, because a normal patient can progress to this fulminant progress in just about 6 to 7 hours time from the onset of hypertensive crisis or coagulopathy. Again, the other thing is, as I said, postpartum hemorrhage, the most common cause of major obstetric hemorrhage. The tissue, thrombus, tone, and trauma, and most importantly for us, the fifth T is theater, because many a times The delay in taking the patient or shifting the patient to the theater, what it leads to morbidity or mortality. And the linchpin in management of major obstetric hemorrhage is nothing but immediate delivery, evacuation of latent products of conception, medical management, judicious use of uterotonics that you have in your armamentarium, surgical methods, calling interventional radiologists at a very early time, involvement of a multidisciplinary team, including obstetric anesthetist, intensivist, and you need to have a targeted resuscitation protocol in your hospital. Well, categorization of acute hemorrhage is more or less what we follow in trauma. Well, we all know this, I don't want to concentrate, but we can categorize hemorrhage only when we know what is the magnitude of blood loss. Well, if you see the uterine blood flow in a term gravid patient is almost about 700 to 800 ml per minute. If it's a multifetal pregnancy, almost 1000 ml per minute. So it takes just about 45 minutes for the mother to get exsanguinated. And you have a grade 1 patient, a class 1 hemorrhage can progress to class 4 in just about 4 to 5 minutes time. And you have very little. And if you have to categorize hemorrhage, you need to assess the blood loss accurately. Well, this is where we fail to do, because most of the time, the calculated blood loss, what we see is we calculate this blood loss. And what we don't calculate is the one that is on the drapes, on the floor, behind the back, or in the kidney trees, or along with the specimen. So you need to have your own protocol to assess the blood loss in your hospital so that assessment is accurate. Because unless the assessment is accurate, replacement always is going to be suboptimal, and blood loss is always underestimated. Moreover, assessment, and whenever you want to replace, you need to know what is the maximum allowable blood loss. If you have to calculate allowable blood loss, what you need to do is you need to know the patient's blood volume. Unlike non-pregnant women, the pregnant patient population, the blood volume is almost about 90 ml per kg. And if the patient has multifetal pregnancy or molar pregnancy, you need to add another 20%. So whenever you have an estimation of maximum allowable blood loss, you need to keep this chart. Of course, we chart it regularly for every major case, and you need to have this in place, because if you assess the blood loss and if you calculate allowable blood loss, your targeted resuscitation is more meaningful and more fruitful, and you can categorize properly. So the targeted resuscitation includes maintaining of circulation and stopping of hemorrhage. We at the head end try to maintain the circulation, and one of the most important things that we have to use are the uterotonics. Majority of the time, and what we have been taught, the uterotonics were by default, we used to depend on the obstetrician to say, but of late, in our hospital, the uterotonics are decided what uterotonics to be used, how much to be used. Probably the anesthesiologist or the intensivist, obstetric intensivist can deal better way. Well, if you have a major hemorrhage not responding to conventional active management of third stage of labor, the uterotonics with the obstetrician uses, then you need to activate the major hemorrhage protocol, and you need to go for the stepping up of uterotonic usage, which is as follows. Oxytocin infusion, 5 to 10 units per hour continuously. Generally, we take 50 units in 50 ml and give about 5 ml per hour to reduce the volume, because if you are adding 40 units in 1 liter, you may end up giving in 15 minutes, and it can cause hemodynamic instability and hypotension. Carboprost, if not a contraindication like bronchial asthma, you can go up to 2 milligrams, 250 micrograms every 15 minutes intramuscularly. Methylergometrin, again, if not a contraindication like preeclampsia, you can go up to almost 0.6 to 0.8 milligrams given intramuscularly or slow intravenously. Misoprostol, buccal or pararectal can be used up to 1,000 micrograms. And carbidocin, of course, is not available, but it has a combination of oxytocin as well as ergot derivative. It's a very potent uterotonic agent. So optimal usage of uterotonics is very important whenever you have a atonic PPH. And the obstetric management, which the obstetrician does, is the tamponade, uterine packing, the tourniquets, compression sutures, so on and so forth. But if the patient demands, if the patient is unstable or hemodynamic unstable, do not delay hysterectomy. It is one of the most important steps to avert or to minimize massive blood loss. And which of the technique is more important is the technique which the surgeon is most familiar with. Like, you can't do a surgeon to do a hysterectomy if they have not done peripartum hysterectomy earlier, and you need to call for help and a right person at the right time. While these things are going happening at the head end, simultaneously what we do at the head end is the fluid resuscitation, because that's the immediate thing which we have in hand. Whether to give crystalloids or colloids, what does the evidence say? If you read the evidence, of course, we don't have strict protocols in major hypovolemic shock in obstetrics, but the data which we have is from the sepsis and the trauma cases, and more or less we have borrowed and used as a surrogate evidence. And there are several trials, the Christmas trial, the 6S trial, the Scandinavian starch for severe sepsis septic shock, and chest and crystalline albuminous trial, where they have compared crystalloids and colloids. Majority of the time, the winner has always been a crystalloid. And among crystalloids, the ringer lactate is still considered to be the gold standard, followed by normal saline. Excessive usage of normal saline beyond 2 liters is not recommended because it can cause hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, because this patient eventually develops renal shutdown, and hyperchloremic acidosis can be a worrying thing. Colloids, yes, a lot of papers which says colloids are not good in major obstetric hemorrhage, or even especially in sepsis, because eventually it can worsen the underlying kidney injury. And similarly, if you are suboptimal resuscitation of obstetric hemorrhage, also can lead to acute kidney injury by AT tubular necrosis, and it can worsen the outcome. And the dosage that we recommend in major obstetric hemorrhage of colloid is low microbial starch in the use, I mean the dosage of 20 ml per kg is what we use. Otherwise, routinely, we don't recommend the use of colloid resuscitation even in major obstetric hemorrhage. The crystal trial is the only trial that the evidence is in support of colloids, but again, not much of evidence. If you read the conclusion, this finding, like the 90-day mortality among colloid resuscitation was little better compared to crystalloid, but again, the conclusion was requires further study before reaching its efficacy universally. So the colloid crystalloid controversy is going to continue for decades, but for us, crystalloids are the fluid of choice. Ringer lactate, if you have, or plasmolite, the balanced salt solution which are available, are equally efficacious because they are truly isosmolar. So our approach is, if the patient is having hypovolemic shock, prevent hypovolemic shock little by proactive multidisciplinary team, call for help early, starch crystalloids and colloids we use in limited quantity, permissive hypertension is what we follow, avoid critical drop in hemoglobin, that's about hemoglobin should not drop to a critical value, which I'll be dealing with later, and assess and procure blood early to avoid dilutional coagulopathy. Blood replacement should be evidence-based. You can't give blood empirically. And generally, whenever you want to give the amount of blood, which what is the right quantity, well, you need to do a bit of underlying physiology, like what is the oxygen delivery and what is the oxygen consumption, the DO2 and the VO2. Normally, the oxygen consumption is 4 times less than delivery. That is, delivery is 4 times more than the oxygen consumption. And oxygen extraction ratio in most of the tissue is almost about 30%. Excluding myocardium, is almost about 80%. So I don't want to, again, if you can recall the physiology, oxygen delivery depends on 4 important factors, the oxygen content in the cardiac output, which depends on the hematocrit, oxygen saturation, contractility in the circulating volume. If you look at this figure, like this, all these monitors are available, the FlowTrack, Vigilio, the EV1000 can give you the VO2 and DO2, and to an extent it helps us in targeted resuscitation. If you see, this is what the oxygen delivery and this was the oxygen consumption is. And if you have a patient with hemoglobin of 15 grams, oxygen delivery is 1,000 ml per minute. What happens, and cardiac output 5 liters. What happens if the hemoglobin drops to 10 grams? Well, if you see hemoglobin drops to 10 grams, the oxygen delivery is reduced by 25%, but still the tissue perfusion is maintained. Well, if the oxygen delivery, if the hemoglobin falls to critical level, let us say hemoglobin falls to 4 grams, you don't have blood in hand, you have been giving only crystalloid resuscitation, the major obstetric hemorrhage is on, the surgeon is unable to control the bleed, what else? If you see, this is where the oxygen debt sets in. The demand is equivalent to supply and there is a debt component. So do not allow hemoglobin to fall less than 4.5 grams, which is the critical level of hemoglobin. So whenever you have to give fluid, the end point of fluid resuscitation should be the hemoglobin should not be allowed to fall to less than 5 grams or 4.5 grams. And that's when the blood and blood component has to be given. But still, if you don't have blood in hand, you are in a, because majority of the time, obstetric cesarean sections are carried out in a peripheral nursing home, what do you do? Well, you start inotropes. By starting inotropes, you are flogging a tired horse. What happens? Slight increase in cardiac output, I mean oxygen delivery is seen, but what after some time, if the blood is still not given, the cardiac output falls, and oxygen delivery is impaired. And virtually the patient going in for organ dysfunction and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. So it is very important that you should give appropriately, the transfusion triggers have to be raised appropriately. like do not allow hemoglobin to fall less than 5 grams. The fluid have to be stopped, and blood components have to be procured on a war-fitting basis. That this can happen only when you have a team approach and a good communication is there between the team person. The goals of anesthetic when you have a major obstetric hemorrhage, general endotracheal anesthesia, of course, if the patient is spinal epidural, convert it to general anesthesia. Put an arterial line early. It's a real boon to have an arterial line early. Use continuous cardiac automotor if you have. If you don't have, it's fine, but at least arterial line is mandatory. Avoid myocardial ischemia, because hemoglobin drop of less than 6 grams and pulse rate of more than 120, myocardial ischemia can occur even in ASA grade 1 patient because of decreased oxygen delivery to the myocardium. Titrate your inhalation agent. Generally, when the patient is in hypovolemic shock, we cut off. So you have to take care of the awareness. Generally, what we use is, we use ketamine pentylmetazolam infusion and antibiotic prophylaxis to prevent any perioperative infections. Avoid lethal thread of hypothermia, acidosis, and coagulopathy. Electrically ventilate. These are the recent guidelines which have been used in the perioperative major hemorrhage, the European Journal of Anesthesia, published in 2013, and the recommendations are 1A, 1B, 1C, and 2A, 2B, 2C, depending on the level of evidence. And they have, the guidelines say that hemoglobin of 7 to 8 grams is good evidence. Monitoring for tissue perfusion indices is always better. So whenever you have a major obstetric hemorrhage, don't hesitate to do a blood gas to know the lactate level. Avoid excessive hyperoxia. Don't give 100% oxygen. See that a PO2 of at least about 150 is good enough. Prophylaxis, prophylactic lysine analogs can be given, and there's good evidence. Tranexamic acid, you can give a loading dose and followed by 500 milligrams 6th hourly. Myocardial ischemia has to be avoided, and you need to have a good, judicious perioperative fluid therapy. Avoid overzealous fluid administration, and you need to give permissive hypotension is what we follow. And two large bores venous cannula are the thing. Do not give inotropes. Use an appropriate size cannula, because majority of the time, even in our center, now the midwives have come into the labor room and they start the peripheral line during normal labor as with a 20 gauge or 22 gauge to minimize discomfort, but they often end up, if the patient has hemorrhage, we are in problem, because to get venous access is difficult. So always green is the cannula which is of choice, 18 gauge. And when there is a major loss, at least see that the 80% of the intravascular compartment is full. Otherwise, the coagulopathy sets in. And the massive transfusion protocol that we follow and we advocate, there is a good amount of evidence, at least in India, to say that 1:1:1:1, there is FFP to Paxil to cryo and to random platelets which are easily available. Single donor platelet in the time of crisis is difficult because it takes about 4 to 6 hours. But 1:1:1 is a recommended protocol, at least in our center, because if you see the recent guidelines, they debate 1:1. And the reason for the debate is, again, you are necessarily giving hypercoagulable factors and it can lead to excessive thrombosis. But majority of the time in our country, to procure blood, it's a challenge and it takes a lot of time and there is a lot of dilution that already has happened. And to circumvent that, this protocol still holds good in our country. The role of NAD blood, recommend factor 7, of course, are the debatable thing, but if possible, yes, NAD is the blood which is of choice if you have it, because it reduces the window period to less than 10 days and you can minimize the long-term sequelae of infections associated with transmission like hepatitis B, C, and HIV. These are the standard endpoints of resuscitation. Lactate clearance is the important thing which you have to remember. And multidisciplinary team approach is a good level of evidence. Escalation of euterotonics, as I have said. Perioperative cell salvage. Yes, it was one of the questions that was put. And there is a level 2C evidence to see, suppose if you are knowingly, if you are taking a case of placenta, preadherent placenta, intraoperative cell salvage is a boon because it minimizes the massive transfusion number of this thing. Point of care hemostatics like TEG and invasive monitoring like at least RTL line is a boon. Avoidance of lethal thread is mandatory. And recombinant factor 7A, not much of literature to support, but there is a case-based series. There is no meta-analysis on this. Cell salvage is a good tool. There's almost level 2C evidence. And radiological cath interventions are a boon. It has to be done at the right time. And more importantly, post-resuscitation care in ICU is very important. This is one of the cases that we are doing a workshop on adherent placenta. And we had Dr. Pailey operating the surgery. And this is what we found. It was large venous sinusoids. We did a classical cesarean section. delivered the baby, but within 1 minute, this is what happened. The patient crashed, hemoglobin fell to 63. You can see how unreliable is non-invasive blood pressure monitoring at this point of time. And the aorta was clamped, and just with clamping of aorta, the pressures improved. And this is the patient has loses 12 liters in less than 5 minutes. And this is a magnitude of blood loss in major obstetric hemorrhage. And especially adherent placenta do not do in a center which doesn't have resuscitation facilities. So to conclude, placenta represents the vascular bed where the coagulation system is an activated state and to prevent catastrophic bleeding during delivery. The DIC in obstetric disorders can arise from spill of heightened placental coagulation system into the systemic circulation. And underestimation of blood loss is then almost by 40%. You need to have a code red or hemorrhage protocol or drills in your hospital. Do not hesitate to use newer devices like gunometer, especially when the patient has oliguria. And invariably, you need to have adequate setup and skilled assistance so as to manage this patient both appropriately, intraoperatively, as well as in the postoperative period. So call right help early, have a wide bore venous access, activate massive transfusion protocol early. Every hospital who have delivery should have MTP protocol, not medical termination of pregnancy, but massive transfusion protocol. Restrict and avoid colloids. Appropriate transfusion triggers have to be activated. And keep the patient warm. Multi-pronged approach. Do not delay hysterectomy. Beware of stump bleeds. Majority of the time, subtotal hysterectomy is done, and the stump bleeds, and it can one of the commonest causes of patient of returning to the theater. Best of ICU strategies needed for the patient in the ICU, and shifting the patient to the higher center if the infrastructure is not there. Most importantly, keep assessing, counting, quantifying, and replacement has to be a continuous process. As Dr. Ramesh said rightly, it is the wisdom, experience, and knowledge, all three are important to tackle such crisis of a major obstetric hemorrhage. I just conclude by next last two slides of our series of a major obstetric hemorrhage from 1997 to 2014. That's when we started our team practice. We had almost about 93 peripartum hysterectomies with zero mortality rate. We don't have a blood bank at Fernandez Hospital, but we have a protocol and systems in place. Amniotic fluid embolism leading to major obstetric hemorrhage, survival rate was 75%. Placement of aortic clamp was needed in one patient. Compression sutures were needed in 87. Failed needing hysterectomy in 3. Uterine ischemia was noted following a compression suture in one patient, which resulted in redo laparotomy for relieving of ischemia. The common iliac occlusion catheters were 18 cases, just half 30 seconds. Common iliac occlusion catheters 18 patients, femoral lateral thrombosis, an embolectomy emergency was needed in 2 patients, embolization in 1 case, massive transfusion in 4 of these patients who had occlusion catheters. So occlusion catheter is not 100% foolproof. We used recombinant factor 7 in 14 cases, extremely helpful in 4 cases, but 10 cases there was no response. One patient had a iliac vein thrombosis, uneventful recovery. Adherent placenta retained, gave methotrexate in 5 cases, 3 had spontaneous expulsion, but one patient landed with pyometra needing emergency hysterectomy. Return to operation theater, redo laparotomies were there in 7 cases, ARDS 17 patients, renal replacement therapy was nil. That is again because of judicious fluid management. Abdominal compartment syndrome was noted in 2 cases, which was a very, very worrying thing, and this is where you require the best of intensive care support for this patient. Acute pancreatitis was noted in 2 patients post-operative cases. Of course, multifactorial help syndrome was one of the underlying cause. Thank you very much.